Time you need auto parts and accessories, trust the parts professionals at the 96 Atlanta area O'Reilly Auto Parts stores. Our professional parts people know what it takes to get the job done right. Professionals have counted on O'Reilly Auto Parts for decades. Now you can too. Professional parts people, O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts, better prices every day.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Welcome to Our Rain Blog Talk Radio with Annie Bell as your host. I am Princess Coop, the producer, and I just want to apologize for the tardiness and some technical difficulties, but we got it all ironed out, and here we are with one of the best shows on Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network. Let's go ahead and get Minister Annie Bell in here. Our Rain host, how are you doing today?
I am very good. Thank you for tuning in, everybody. And we know technical difficulties happen, but it's about persevering. So
thank you for
sticking in there with us. As she said, I am Minister Annie Bell, the host and creator of I-Rain Blog Talk Radio Show, which is an outreach of Wealth Management Ministries Incorporated. We are endeavoring to bring talk therapy to survivors of child abuse, sex trafficking, and other traumas, as well as providing awareness, prevention, and resources to the community. We done kicked off a new series of Ending Sex Trafficking for the month of September. Next week, we're actually going to hear from a person who is going to talk to us about how to prevent it from a teenager standpoint. But before we get started, I want to thank Virginia Lynn from Small Business Connections for the great show she just aired. And, of course, I want to always thank Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network for the opportunity and the platform. So let's get started. There is a big difference between sex trafficking and prostitution, and we talked about that last week, but I wanted to reiterate for those who may have missed it last week, because it's not the same. As I mentioned, Dahlia Racine, who is the assistant district attorney for DeKalb County of Georgia, defines sex trafficking as the manufacturing of children and other people for the sex trade. Sex trafficking is heinous in its methodology that is utilized. It includes enslavement and forced selling of victims' bodies for the sole purchaser's sexual pleasure. They sell the person from trafficker to trafficker or to the highest individual bidder to be held captive as their personal sex slave, whether it's for an hour or whether it's for years. In order to end sex trafficking, we really have to understand the beast that we are dealing with. Not only are people being kidnapped, enslaved, and forced into the sex industry, but they are also being lured in with promises of love, money, or better standard of living. What is so very intriguing to me is how people, especially females, are lured in with the promise of love. What could be the causation that leaves a girl, teenager, an adult, woman yearning to be loved so deeply that the promise of love is enough to make them acquiesce to selling their bodies over and over again to strangers in order that they may gain the love of the very person who is exploiting them. For the majority, it is some sort of childhood trauma that left a void or a distorted view of what real love is supposed to be like. Now, if you also remember, at the beginning in July, we talked about Dr. Folletti, who led a call, he led a study called Adverse Childhood Experience, or the ACE, stated a direct correlation between childhood trauma and neurobiological effects, risky behavior, disease, disability, and social problems. Being able to be lured by the promise of love falls in the category of social problems because it speaks to the survivor's negative self-image, self-esteem, and other perceptions about themselves. Especially when those who have endured child sexual abuse, because it normalizes what otherwise is considered demoralizing, degraded, and perverted sex. So their view of sex is already skewed. Today, our guest is another survivor of childhood trauma. She, too, went down a tainted path first, was rescued, and now has dedicated her life to rescuing others. Gosh, I love what I do because it gives me the opportunity to meet people who are exuding with awesome sauce. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to Minister Victoria Teague, who is the founder of Victoria's Friends. We're going to hear a little bit about her story and about her ministry, as well as learn some more about the sex trafficking and the sex industry. I am honored to have Minister Teague on our show today. Welcome to the show, Minister.
Thank you so much, Annie. I'm delighted to be here.
Thank you. I'm glad. We normally always get started with getting to know our guests. So we want to start at the beginning. And if you don't mind, we're going to just jump right into it. Could you share with us the type of trauma you experienced as a child or a teenager?
Absolutely. I was raised in pretty much an upper middle class family. And we looked like a normal family, like an upper middle class family with three children, and was involved in cheerleading, tap, jazz, and ballet. But my father was very keyed into his career. So even though he was providing a nice lifestyle, he was very absent relationally. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very important to know that going into my story. When I was 13, my sister got sick. And when I was 15, she died of cancer.
Wow.
So that devastated our family. We would only go to church for Easter and Christmas. So we really didn't have a strong spiritual foundation in Jesus to lean on.
Mm-hmm.
So if you've ever lost anyone of cancer, it is devastating.
Sure.
That just rocked our world. A year later, the very football player, I was in involved in the pep club and cheerleading, that kind of thing at school. A football player who had come to my sister's funeral, he invited me to a party at a coach's trailer. And I went, and we were drugged, and I was raped while the coach filmed it. So it was a high school scandal, yes. And so not only I had lost my sister, and then that hit, it was so humiliating, you know, to lose your virginity, not only to lose it through a rape,
sure,
but for it to go public and for there to be a court case and all of that with a teacher/coach involved.
Wow.
So that was very humiliating. And then a year after that, my grandfather died.
Mm.
So I just went off the deep end, Annie, after that. It was
yes.
just 3 years of trauma.
Yes.
So I know
yes.
he died. My mother grabbed at alcohol to kind of numb the pain and just to get through crises after crises. And I followed in her footsteps, and I started drinking alcohol, running with the wrong crowd. Next thing I knew, I was doing drugs, ended up loving cocaine because it made me feel like my world was right.
Mm-hmm.
So I was
yeah.
filling this empty void with drugs and alcohol.
Yeah.
And sure enough, I met the wrong guy in that crowd. And he said, "Hey, man, I know how you can make a lot of money. And guess what? You're going to be discovered. You're going to be famous."
Mm-hmm.
So, and boy, that right there, that hit that father wound.
Yes,
I carried
yes.
a father wound. I wanted a male to look at me and tell me I was special.
Mm.
And that was that wound, and it hit that button for me, and it was a hook. So
wow.
he took me around to the local strip clubs in Atlanta and introduced me to the sex industry. And the first time we did an amateur contest, that's how they get new ones in, and they let one girl win. And I believe that he rigged it so I could win.
Right.
So the first amateur contest I did, I won.
Wow.
Wow. And I think then this was in the 80s. I'm dating myself here.
We won't tell anybody.
It was 1983. And it was the club actually is still on Cheshire Bridge Road. It was called the Hot Spot at the time, but it's actually Club Silhouette right now.
Wow.
So I went in and I won the first amateur contest I did. And he said, "See, you're a natural. You're good at this." And, you know, I hated it. I loved every minute of it.
Mm.
I have to be honest. I loved the attention.
Mm-hmm.
I loved the lights. I loved the men. I loved the money. Well, as you know, all honeymoons with sin ends.
Right.
There's a honeymoon phase, and then wham, you get slammed
right
into the wall. So I hung out in those circles for 4.5 years.
Wow.
My cocaine addiction grew worse and worse to be able to stay in it. A couple of my friends died. One of them, she had been abused so badly, and then her boyfriend was abusing her, and she was a stripper, and she just snapped and shot herself in the head. And that was very hard for me, and I thought, you know, that was about 3 years in. I said, I am not going to be famous. I haven't met a single movie producer in this.
Right.
You know, and everybody was just going down, and another girl was killed. And it was just, it was really a nasty business, you know. It's just kind of like a frog. If you put it in warm water, it's not going to die. But the water keeps getting hotter and hotter, and the frog doesn't realize till it's dead.
Mm-hmm.
It was that
right
sort of thing. All of a sudden, I'd look at myself in the mirror. I wasn't the same girl that went into it.
Right.
I was so strung out on cocaine at the end. I was barely 100 pounds.
Oh my God.
And one night I was dancing at the Cheetah. Now, when on the honeymoon phase, I'd say the first 2 years in it, I made a lot of money. There were a lot of famous musicians that came in, and it, you know, it did kind of have that celebrity feel to it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, there's a glamorization to that industry.
There
yes
is. It's there. That's one of the hooks for the ladies. As you stay in it, though, and you start losing your look, and it's no longer new, and you're more addicted, you know, you start getting to the end of it. One night, here I was 100 pounds dancing at the Cheetah, and I started having spontaneous nosebleeds because I had burned all the cartilage out of my nose with cocaine.
Oh, goodness gracious.
So I called my drug dealer. I said, "What's going on? You gave me bad stuff. My nose is bleeding while I'm dancing." And he goes, no, honey. He goes, "You're at the point where you're going to have to run it." He goes, "If you want to do it anymore,
oh,
you're going to have to shoot it into your veins." And,
amazing,
you know, Annie, during those crazy parties in high school when I was drinking, I saw a guy that somebody brought some drugs in, and a guy shot up, and he seizured, and it almost killed him.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw that, and that was God, because that scared me to death. The guy turned purple. They threw him in the bathtub. They had to dump ice on him. It was a miracle he lived.
Oh, my.
And I swore at that moment I would never put a needle in my arm. And so when you guys put a needle in your arm, I was like, I can't do that. I am not that crazy. I'm not going to do that. And that probably saved my life. But
praise God.
I know. So I was dancing at the Cheetah, you know, 100 pounds, nosebleeds. And a guy comes in who was a regular, and I remember his name was Morris. Isn't that funny, the things you remember years later?
Yeah,
but he
it
said,
really is.
"What are you doing?" He goes, "What are you doing?" And I said, "I'm dancing. I'm going to be famous." And he said, "Honey, you're not going to be famous." He goes, "You're a cocaine whore."
Wow.
And I was like, oh, gosh, that truth, it just... You know, I believe that was God getting ready to rescue me, because wham, it just hit me in the gut. And I was like, oh, my gosh, what has happened to me? You know, so right after that, I got fired. That's a faux place to be. You look so bad. You've lost your look. You're so skinny. You got to get out of here. You're not going to work this club anymore.
Wow.
Whoa, is that a low place? So
I mean,
I went back.
And to think about it, you know, to add insult to injury, you know, you've given all that you can, and you're doing all this stuff just to turn around and be fired because you're not looking the part anymore. So go ahead. I just wanted to inject that. Yeah.
Yes, and I had had 3 abortions while I was in the industry as well.
Wow.
You know, life is not looking pretty at this point at all.
Mm-hmm.
So I went back to my drug dealer, and he said, well, you're going to have to kick cold.
Oh,
I was like, you're going to have to get off these drugs, get your stuff together, and get some weight on you. And I said, all right. So he tied me to a bed for 48 hours.
Oh, my gosh. That's cold turkey.
It was cold turkey, and it was crazy. I found out later from a nurse, she said, you know, I could have died easily.
Sure.
I could have had a heart attack.
Certainly, because your body can only take but so much, you know.
Oh, yeah. I had sweat and vomiting and cold chills, and it felt like fire ants crawling up and down my spine. Afterwards, he untied me and, you know, I just kind of laid around. He said, you just smoke some pot and try to get some weight back on you, right? He was trying to get me back to the clubs to dance.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
He was like a boyfriend / pimp, you know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, God. So I laid around, and so he was working at a furniture store because, you know, he would sell drugs, he'd use ladies, he'd use their money. Then he would pick up, a job if he had to, if he wasn't making it. So he was over at a furniture store, and the accountant in the office, her name is Pam Yonker, and she came in, and he said, look, I need you to pray. Or no, not pray. He said, I need help with my girlfriend. He said, she's just, you know, she's suicidal, she's drug addict, she's a stripper. Yeah, I don't know what to do with her. She's just laying around at the house.
Hmm.
And Pam said, bring her to my church.
Wow.
I mean, who would have said that?
Right.
I said, they're like, check her into drug rehab, you know.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Pam said, bring her to my church.
Wow.
So she gave
well, she know where the power is. You know. Amen.
So she gave him singing Christmas tree tickets. Now, I don't even know if you know what a singing Christmas tree is. I know a lot of people don't.
Yeah, probably not. It's not the one that you open and it plays music?
No, this is
okay.
It's actually at the church. It's a live performance.
Mm-hmm.
And they actually have this gigantic tree on the stage, and people climb up into it.
Oh.
And someone gets to be very top where the star is, and they sing, and they do Christmas programs.
Wow.
This was in the 80s and the early 90s. And
okay.
Then, do you know Babbie Mason? She's a gospel.
I do,
singer.
Yes.
Okay. So Babbie was there for that performance. So my drug dealer actually took me to Pam's church, and we go in, and they're up in this tree singing. And Babbie Mason comes out on the stage, and she sings about this man that's going to burst through the eastern sky. And they're singing about Jesus. But I was looking at everybody, and I was like, oh, my gosh, these people believe this.
Mm-hmm.
They're not just, you know, this isn't just a show.
Right.
They believe what they're singing. And Annie, the aroma of Christ just wound up in me. And I looked, and the men were dressed in, you know, suits, and their children were in Christmas clothes, and everybody looked so pretty. I just remember everybody was like, beautiful, because
mm-hmm.
I had been in those dingy, smoky clubs for 4 and a half years. And I just remember saying, I want what they have. I want it.
Jesus.
Now, at the same time, 2 people sitting at that performance, Pam Yonker had 50 people praying for us. Her whole
wow.
Sunday school class and everybody that could, she could think of. And so Steve hated it, the drug dealer. He hated it. And he ran out of the church kind of mad that night. I loved it, left wanting to go back. So everybody asked Pam, what happened to the guy that we were praying for? And she's like, well, we didn't get him, but we got his girlfriend.
Amen. Well, you were the one. But, you know,
isn't it how
God, just like God, that will use him to bring you to the church, you know, and he couldn't stand it, but it was for you. It was your day for salvation. And amen. Yes.
6 weeks later, I went down and accepted Jesus Christ at that church. And wow. Pam Yonker ended up, her family ended up taking me in, mm-hmm. nursing me back to health. She's interesting to talk to because she describes how I looked when she first saw me. And mm-hmm. she said, I just almost gasped.
Wow.
She was like a skeleton of a girl. I'd had hair extensions that you wear when you strip,
right.
but mine were half fallen out.
And how old were you at that point?
I danced a little older than some people. I danced from 23 to 27.
And, you know,
and
you call that old, but really that's you're still young. But in mm-hmm. that type of industry, it, you know, because the way you look and everything is so important or, you know, that's mm-hmm. what the focal point is, that it dates you even harsher than, you know, it should.
Right.
So that was your turning point. Your turning point was basically not wanting to intravenously use drugs and then hearing about Christ. Amen?
Right.
Right.
Absolutely.
And so that is wonderful. You know, and one of the things that I wanted to ask you was, while you were in the industry, do you recall seeing anyone that may have looked like a victim of sex trafficking?
You know, it's interesting that you ask that. Now, I was in the industry from 83 to 89.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's been a while that it wasn't even a term. No one really talked about it back then.
Right. It wasn't.
We had several ladies end up missing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, thinking back on it and that were never found. And then I even remember one, she had a regular customer that would come in. And they were thinking that he might have killed her, so they went out and drug his lake. He lived out by a lake and all that. But they never found her body.
Wow.
So, you know, thinking back on that, I wonder if those ladies were actually being trafficked.
Mm-hmm. And,
boy, I just had an angel because I was really stupid when I danced. And
mm-hmm.
I would go, you know, towards the end, I would go off with customers and all. They tell you not to.
Mm-hmm,
you know, don't
right.
ever give someone a phone number or go off with someone you meet in this club. Of course, the girls do it all the time.
Yes, yes. And there is. It seems to be a natural escalation from stripping to then, you know, prostitution. Would you agree?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely. And it is prostitution.
Yes.
You know, when I danced, I would have never said I was a prostitute.
Yeah.
Yet I had all these boyfriends from the club that paid for my mortgage. They paid for my car. They bought, at one point, one guy bought me a sports car. I had all this jewelry from them. Yeah, it's prostitution.
Yeah, it really is because it's selling, you know, sexual acts. But I love the fact that you are able to, one, you survived, and two, you're able to talk about how glamorous it was, but really it is not. When in hindsight, you see how degrading and demoralizing, dehumanizing it is, the industry is. And so this is the type of conversation we need to have to make sure our youngins understand that it is a true trade-off. You trade your life for these material gains, if you're not being forced. Now, there are some, yes, as we're talking about in the sex industry, the sex trafficking, that there are a lot being forced into it. But it's
yes.
not a lifestyle of choice. It is not the rich and famous. The road does not end pretty. I skipped one of our commercials because your story was so intriguing. I actually forgot. So, but to make sure that I get my bills paid, I'm going to stop right here. So let's put a bookmark and let's take a quick break and come right back. Thank you
okay.
so much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Down, afraid to let out shackles.
Welcome back to the R.E.I.G.N Blog Talk Radio Show. I just love our theme song because it really speaks about what we're trying to do. It's not about just R.E.I.G.N as an Annie Bell, but I, whoever speaks it. Reign above, reign over the pain that of the past. And so I love that song. And it also talks about that we will reign together with Christ if we will endure. So I do want to take a moment to thank our pillar sponsors, the one who wrote and composed this song and recorded it and sang it, did all of it himself, Clifton Dial, our musical director. I also want to thank Numa Designs for all of their corporate branding that they do for us, our flyers and logos and everything else. And, of course, by the way, for those who are have a business or have a ministry or organization, please consider advertising with us. Our platform has 1.8 million listeners, and so and that's afforded by the Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network. So call us. Our rates are so affordable. If you're just tuning in, we are talking to Minister Victoria Teague, the founder of Victoria's Friends. Now, Minister Teague, I'm trying so hard not to say Victoria's Secret that I didn't say your name right, so I apologize. My focus is like, don't say Victoria's Secret. So Victoria Teague, she is the founder of Victoria's Friends, and we're going to hear about what her organization does. It's so important that we as survivors of any trauma can turn around and help others. So I applaud what she does. My next question is, from your experience, would you say that there is a direct correlation of childhood abuse and trauma and the propensity of the survivor to go into the sex industry?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Everybody we've helped has been abused, molested, either by a family member or a stranger. And I'm going to say 1%, Annie, maybe 1% hasn't. Occasionally
We'll
have a girl that says she hasn't.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that something?
Huge connection. It's almost like a magnet that pulls you back.
Yes,
Until you can get it healed.
Mm-hmm.
Once you
that's the operative word, getting it healed. Because we're in this world, we're in fallen nature, and so we're going to go through some things, and our survivor responses or coping mechanisms will kick in. And sometimes, especially if it's at a childhood, if it happens at childhood, we don't have all the information and the experiences to help us to make our survivor responses more positive. And so there is that tendency that it will go away. And so I agree with you as well. The other question that I have is, in your opinion, are the laws strict enough to end sex trafficking? Are they strict enough?
I think we're making great strides.
Yes.
At least here in Atlanta, we're located out of Atlanta, Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
I think in the city of Atlanta, we're making some really big strides. We have ministries like Street Grace.
Yes.
Really getting in and making sure that the pimps and the men forcing these women in are having stricter penalties. Not only that, they're making sure that these victims aren't being charged with prostitution.
That's exactly
that
right.
That was like the biggest shame of all, is that the victim was slapped on the hand and punished for prostitution after being forced into it.
Exactly.
I see a lot shifting, and then I see a lot of awareness. I heard a story of a police officer that pulled someone over, and he knew something wasn't right. The guy's story driving wasn't adding up with the girl in the passenger seat.
That's
and
right.
Sure enough, he was getting ready to sex traffic. He was getting ready to sell her off.
Yes.
He opened the trunk. It had all the hotel addresses, the phone numbers, and all of it. They busted him.
Mm-hmm.
And he was part of a ring. So that was amazing. So the police are being more trained.
Yes.
Look for it.
Yes.
Which, that is awesome. That is so, so awesome.
And that is one of the key points, that the awareness has to happen. And I read that same story where he had been trained to be able to identify. And so he could tell by the way she was not making eye contact with him, her nonverbal display of communication. He picked up on all those very subtle clues or cues to be able to know, okay, something is not, the stories are not adding up. Something doesn't smell right.
Mm-hmm.
And so I applaud that officer and for doing that. And I agree with you. The penalty for those who are sex trafficking need to be more harsh in order, not just a slap on the wrist, but in order for them to really not want to do it again. And you're right. Again, the saddest part is that the person, the victim, who actually will have to do jail time for prostitution, that is egregious. And then, of course, they then have a scar or a black mark on their record for the rest of their lives for something that they were not trying to do. That needs to be fixed right away. One of the reasons that when I talked to an officer, one of the reasons that they did that, they said, is because especially for the youth, there's nowhere for them to take the youth to ensure that they will not go back into the industry or they will not be taken back by the pimp or the trafficker. How sad is that?
Oh, it's heartbreaking.
Yeah, it really is. That's one of the things that we're endeavoring to do as Wealth Management Ministries this year. It's our prayer that we will have the funds to be able to open up these safe houses, transitional homes, and give them the nurturing they need in order to transition from that past life to the new life and have life abundant. So I appreciate you coming on and just speaking so candidly about that. What is one of the most heartbreaking stories that you have heard from a sex trafficking victim or a prostituting victim?
Wow. We have many. We've been out there for 15 years.
Wow.
Reaching. I guess the saddest ones to us are the ones that we don't save or rescue, you know.
Yeah.
I know God's saving everybody, but the ones
who
are not rescued. I had, this is kind of a typical, you know, hotline call. I got a hotline call come in. The mother was in Alabama, and she said her daughter was here in Atlanta stripping. And she said she had a very bad sense about it because she came in with a big fancy car, and that these men were promising her this, that, and the other. And the mother was very uneasy about all of it, asking her to get out.
Mm-hmm.
And she had asked her to call the hotline. So we were looking, we had pictures, and we go into the strip clubs and into the dressing rooms with baskets of love.
Mm-hmm.
And we looked for her. Her name was Allison. And then I got the sad phone call from her mother that they had found her dead in a hotel on Rockwell Road here in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that one broke our hearts, but come to find out, the police called us. Of course, I did not get a chance to talk to Allison.
Mm-hmm.
So she never even, you know, gave us a chance to go in and rescue or help. But there was definitely some sort of connection to sex trafficking or foul play. A lot of things were not adding up in the investigation on that one.
Wow.
So we don't know. They found the guy that was buying her the cars and all that. And we're not sure if he sold her to someone that murdered him. That was just a heartbreaking, absolutely heartbreaking one for us. Another one was a 14-year-old that was 14. And we were absolutely able to help her.
Amen.
We were able to help her, yes. And we moved her in with people that her mother knew that was a pastor and a pastor's wife. This couple were just lovely, and they did beautifully with her.
Amen.
And she done very, very well. I mean, she was forced into this at 14. And it was 19. She was 19 when we helped. She had been more 14 to 19 than most adults would ever, you know, and no one would ever want to see in their lifetime.
And she has to deal with all those memories, you know, of people violating her body and taking her virginity. And it's so sad, but there is always, there's still hope.
You know how it started? She went, she was raised in poverty, and she snuck out of her house and went to strip.
Wow.
That's how the whole thing started. I know, it just broke my heart.
Mm-hmm.
It was amazing. She was able to get away from him, and a pastor and his wife took her in, and she's doing beautifully now. She's
that
doing something
wonderful.
With computers, very successful. Of course, you have to deal with post-traumatic stress disorder.
Sure, yes,
so what
definitely.
We do is we line up medical attention,
mm-hmm.
a lot of medical care. One of our ladies that we've been so, so proud of, Annie, her name is Brandy. She was stopped when she left her shift. You know, they get off at 4 and 5 a.m.
Yes.
in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
So it leads them, you know, that right there, a female traveling alone at that time of night is not the greatest thing.
That's right.
And so she was stalked, and the guy, she felt someone following up her stairs to her apartment. She could feel someone, and
yes.
she got her key in the door, and then she saw him. And she got the door open, but she left the key in it and slammed it.
Oh, my gosh.
He got in, and he beat her and raped her. When he was beating her, she was swinging her purse, which called the last number she had dialed was her boyfriend.
Uh-huh.
The phone called her boyfriend
wow.
while she was swinging it at them. And he heard the whole thing and called the police. But by the time they got there, he had already beaten her really bad. And she locked herself in the bathroom, not knowing if the guy was going to be coming in and out
Jesus.
Since he had her key.
Right.
And she was terrified. So she called the hotline and has completely transitioned out of stripping. She's done a training now. She has a corporate job.
Amen.
And we've been able to give her a full scholarship to get on track.
That is so wonderful. That is so wonderful. And
very
success
story, definitely. And many of the ladies are transitioning out.
Yes. Wow. I mean, that has got to be so rewarding to know that you're hands-on and was able to help and then see the transition, not just wonder what
right.
had happened, but to be able to know that she has transitioned well and is doing well. That has got to be one of the best rewards ever, you know, in the
–
yes, while we're advocating.
When they make it out, it's a great thing. It's sad when we lose some.
Right.
It's heartbreaking. But the ones that make it out make it all worth it, definitely.
Yeah. And, you know, I was I had gotten a call this over the weekend about a possibility that one of their children was out being prostituted by her boyfriend. And what was heartbreaking for me is when I called to try to help, either she was too scared or was had not been hurt enough to actually take the help, to accept the help, still kind of in denial and still in rebellion and still wanting to make sure that the person who is victimizing them, her, was not going to get in trouble. And I thought, I mean, I really, my spirit just grieved because we know what that road looks like. It gets worse before it gets better. And so, and then when you're handing out that olive branch, that your hand to come on, let's, you know, let us help you get out. When they don't take it, it's so heartbreaking. And, it's hard to process that because I know that she's already have not experienced, you know, good things. And but it still was not enough yet. But, you know, we all have our, I guess, our areas of how far we need to go before we finally say this is enough. So it's time again for one more commercial. When I come back, I do want to hear a little bit about how Victoria's friends are rescuing the victims. So everybody, please stay tuned. We'll be right back in 2 minutes.
the Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network would like to welcome the following shows. Spiritually Sweet Talk Radio with Minister Sherilyn Bennett from Gainesville, Florida. In Times Like These with host Benita Coney from Gainesville, Florida. Also, Small Business Connections in Virginia Lynn, also from Gainesville, Florida. Irene Annie Bell out of Atlanta, Georgia. Amazing Minds from Lena Jermaine Hurst Clark in Atlanta, Georgia. Truth Radio from Tifton, Georgia, and Pastor Cal. The Roro Show with Rochelle Rose from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Pave Your Way to Success with Michelle and Rudy Govan. Also, Power 803 with John Robinson, Columbia, South Carolina. We are a better network for having you aboard.
Again, welcome back. This is Irene Blog Talk Radio, and I am Minister Annie Bell with Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network. We have been talking with Minister Teague today with Victoria's Friends, and we've been talking about how and what we should do with this whole epidemic of not just the abuse, but the sex trafficking and the whole sex industry. When we left, we were talking, she was talking about some of the people she was able to rescue. Yes, she's had some that she wasn't able to reach before they, passed away or had some egregious thing happen to them. But she has definitely been able to help many in her 15 years of being an advocate and a shero, that I would deem her. Welcome again, Minister Teague. I wanted to ask you if you could share with us about Victoria's Friend and how do you go about rescuing these victims in the sex trafficking industry?
Yes, we have outreach teams, and I have about 50 volunteers.
Wow.
I run about 5 outreach teams that go into the strip clubs.
Okay.
And we take baskets of love because mm-hmm. the dancers, they never get anything for free.
Wow,
and
that's true.
And they're beautiful. Yes, and they're always like, how much do you want for this, or can I pay you? And we're like, no, it's absolutely a free gift. The Proverbs say that a gift opens the way to the heart, and it really does. It just touches them so much. And we said, we're just here to tell you about our support group, Victoria's Friends. And Victoria used to dance, and she knows exactly what you're going through. She didn't have a lot of friends. She was estranged from her family at the time, and we started this group. If you want to transition out, we have a pathway and we can help you. And it's amazing when we go in. It's just, before, it starts off a little cold, but then they start looking at the gift bags and they love it. They have scarves and journals. And I like something with the word in it. Sometimes we have Bible or just, some evangelistic piece that has the word, because that's the life.
That's right.
Their lifeline. And so they start digging through their gifts, and they love them. And then I just, the aroma of Christ circles around.
Amen.
And all of a sudden, I said, I was in this, and I was really lonely. And as I start talking to them like that, the tears start coming.
Mm.
And then they'll say, I'm here tonight to raise the money to pay for an abortion. We have been able to save babies as well.
What?
And that's always
love
that we've been able to help women not to have their abortions.
That
so that
awesome.
Has been great.
I am sure. Oh my gosh.
That's been sweet for me since I fell victim to 3 abortions while I was in it.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, no, you don't want to go that route. The abortions are really harder to get healed than rape. That's what I found with my experience. I was so grieved. When I had my own son, it hit me, and I realized what I had done.
Yes.
That I had murdered three babies, and I was so, that was a grievous. Plus, you have the anniversary date of when you did it.
That's right.
Every year, and you've got to get that healed.
That's right.
The beautiful ministry, PACE, post-abortion
yes.
counseling and education.
Mm-hmm.
And we partner with all kinds of resources. You know, you can't do it all. It takes a community.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have resources for them to have a home if they need one. And we partner with several homes in the community. We do job training and Wellspring Living. I don't know if you're familiar with that.
Yes,
ministry.
I am. Mm-hmm.
They have very solid job training, which actually Brandy, the lady I told you about that was raped and stalked, she just came through their training and has a corporate job now.
Wow,
so
that is
amazing.
A testament.
Yeah. So you need. I encourage everybody to take the community and to use those resources. Our
That's
specialty
right.
is to really go in with a basket of love, give them a phone number and a lifeline,
mm-hmm.
and we point them to Christ immediately.
Amen. Amen.
And then we have a group that they come to, and they can find out about what resources we have available to help them. We also have scholarships available. If we see that they're very serious about pulling out, we've paid for college, we've gotten cars for the ladies. I mean, the
wow.
community has been very, very gracious.
Amen.
And
Amen.
Really blessed us to help them make it. Because if you
yeah.
don't have a car, you know, you're pretty, it's pretty tough to get to an interview. You're pretty limited in Atlanta without a vehicle.
It really is. I mean, I know the MARTA tries to fulfill the need, but Metro Atlanta, I believe, has 162 counties. So, you know, I live in a rural area, and for me to go and get to Atlanta or other places that are deemed Atlanta could take about an hour by car. So just imagine mm-hmm. trying to hop, you know, three buses, two trains, and all that to get to there. Now, one thing I do know, having a charitable organization myself, I know how hard it is to get funding. So in about 2 minutes, if you could share with us if you have any fundraiser that's going on currently, I want you to tell our listeners how to get in touch with you to donate. And the last thing I'm going to ask of you is if you could leave us with a quote or a scripture that will that kept you during your most troubled times. But definitely start out with how we can get in touch with you and make some donations.
Yes, you can reach us at victoriasfriends.com. And you can make a donation right through the website. We have PayPal, or you can make a check out to Victoria's Friends. Our address is on the website. I think that's the best way to get the main amount of information. We also look for baskets of love to be donated and those items, and we have sheets on the website that tell, you know, it's not specific items, but just in general what we're looking for.
Okay.
A lot of we have church partners and private organizations that provide funding, the scholarships, and the basket.
That is wonderful. Great. And what quote kept you or scripture kept you during your most troubled times?
It's hard to get it down to one.
I know.
I have several, but, you know, it's very important for a victim to be heard.
Yes.
And I tell you, that's the main thing we do with the ladies is we hear them, we listen to them. Psalms 18:6 says, "In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to him for help. From his temple, he heard my voice.
Heard me. Amen.
My cry came before him into his ears."
Mm.
And then one more, Annie, with Psalms 124:6-8. "Blessed be the Lord who has not given us to be torn by their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the trapper. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth." And I tell all the ladies, they have escaped.
Amen.
Hell.
It's so powerful.
Yes. From eternal
yes.
hell and
oh
really earthly hell in this lifestyle.
That's right.
You know, they've escaped both. So those
That's
two
right.
are very, very special to me.
Amen. And I appreciate you sharing that with us. If you can stay on, I just wanted to share some thoughts before we leave, but I do want to let you know how thankful I am for, one, what you're doing out in the trenches, rolling up your sleeves and showing forth your compassion. I love that. That is the spirit of Christ all over. I pray abundance in your ministries, that you'll be able to reach out to even more. And I also, you know, I know it's been years, but my condolences to your sister, my my producer of this show. Her mother passed with cancer. So I know the cancer goes, and it seems to seep in through all and hit all the demographics. And so my heart goes out to you and all those who have gone through that tragedy in your lives. As a last thought, there is definitely no ifs, ands, or buts about it. In order to end sex trafficking, a few things must happen simultaneously. The punishment has to be more harsh for the ones on the demand side. If that happens, the supply side won't exist because it won't have enough money. It's not lucrative enough to keep doing it. Secondly, as parents, we have to do our part to love, nurture, and teach our children, not abuse them or let them be abused. That is, the least we can do for the little ones that we actually brought into this world. That part is a no-brainer. Lastly, we have to have more services available for those who are being rescued out of the sex trafficking industry, out of the sex industry. This year, like I said earlier, Wealth Management Ministries, we're endeavoring to open up those safe houses and transitional facilities and long-term care homes where the survivors can receive the nurturing, healing resources and transitional skills that will enable them to thrive in their new lives. Your support for our show and our ministry can make that happen, so we thank you for tuning in every week. Also wanted to let you know on I Rain, Stop Abuse and Fight Back on Facebook, you can go on our Facebook page, and there are some resources. And there's a resource that we just put on there today on fact sheets about the human trafficking. So it talks about sex trafficking and human slavery. So I would, ask everyone to go and pick that up so you can take a look. To make a donation or get in touch with me or my team, please go to www.wealthmngt.org, or, again, follow us on Facebook and Twitter at IRAIN, Stop Abuse and Fight Back. For those who did not hear, we are taking nominations for survivors who not only survive child abuse but thrive and is now helping to do the same with others. It's our first annual More Than Conqueror Award, and that comes with a monetary gift. Nominate yourself or someone else that you know. Just go to our website and fill out the very short form. And, again, that's www.wealthmngt.org. Again, I want to thank Never Had It So Good Sports Media Network. Coming up next is Refresh Radio Show with Pastor Regina Johnson from Conroe, Texas. It's our responsibility as survivors to help others survive. Let's reign together with Christ. See you next week. Bye-bye.
time you need auto parts and accessories, trust the parts professionals at the 96 Atlanta area O'Reilly Auto Parts stores. Our professional parts people know what it takes to get the job done right. Professionals have counted on O'Reilly Auto Parts for decades. Now you can too. Professional parts people. O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts, better prices every day.
Oh, O'Reilly Auto Parts.